So far, we have just dealt with impulse responses. So how is this with the frequency response? So remember the frequency response, if we have a digital filter, H offset, then the frequency response is just generated by substituting E to J omega into this Z here. And in turn, the omega runs from minus pi to plus pi. And pi is the Nyquist frequency. And this is here the negative Nyquist frequency. So in our filter here, we have, just to recap how this looked like, it was 1 minus and then 1 multiplied Z to minus 1 for the FIR part. And then this is here 1 minus and then E to S infinity T plus E to S infinity star T Z to minus 1 delayed by 1 time step and then plus E to 2 times the real value of S infinity T, and then this delayed by 2 time, by 2 time steps here. So that's our function H of Z. And so now our E to J omega is then just substituting this here into our function. So 1 minus Z to not Z, but E2 minus J omega. Yeah, so we're just substituting this in here, and then we have 1 minus, and then E2 S infinity T, and then E2 S infinity star T, and then we've got here E2 minus J omega, plus, and then E2 to real of S infinity T, and then we've got here E2 minus 2 J omega. So we see the idea is very simple. So we are substituting the E2 minus J omega here instead of the Z2 minus 1. Okay, then let's bring up octave here. So there we've got octave here. And so let's set our parameters here again. Q is, let's set Q at 10. And then I just copy and paste here the definition of S in here. So this was our complex pole S here, S infinity. And then I just copy here the FIR coefficients in there. So these were the FIR coefficients that we've done before. So that's our 1 here, and that's our minus 1 here. So this was just out of pure laziness. I could have just typed this in. What is a bit more complex here are our IRR coefficients here. So that's our 1 here, and then the EXP of S and the conjugated S infinity here. And then we add our exponential of 2 times the real value of the S infinity here. So these are our IRR coefficients. I should just add this here. So these are our IRR coefficients. So now for the frequency response, we just need to define our omega here. So that's running from 0 to in steps of 0.01 to pi. So that's our frequency vector. And so now what we just need to do is just create our transfer function. So first the one here, that's our B of 1 coefficient here. And so this has no exponential, and then we add our B of 2 coefficient. That's our minus 1 here, and we multiply this with exp of minus j omega. With that, we've got our numerator sorted. And so now we just need to take care of this one here. So this is A0 here, this is the 1. I could have also written just 1 because by convention this that's A1 because we're starting from 1 here. And so then we add this up now with A of 2. A of 2 is this coefficient here, which is sitting here. And we multiply this here with exp of minus j omega. Oops, there's an and sign sneaked in here. Okay, so we have done this. And then we multiply this with a of 3. A of 3 is this coefficient here, and it shows up here. And we multiply this with exp of minus 2 times j omega. So then we close the bracket here. And what I've forgotten here is that you would like to have an element-wise division and not treat this as a matrix. So now we've got our h here. So let's plot the amplitude. And here we're getting a beautiful resonance out here. So just now, these are just samples here. So we need to take care of the samples here. And we know this is 0 here, and this is our normalized frequency 0.5 here. So we just create a lint space and fix that. So let's create our, let's call this here f might be a bit, let's call this as x here, lint space from, and we create a vector from 0 to 0.5. And with the number of elements of h, and then we plot this here with proper axes. And so now we have our filter response with proper normalized frequencies here, and we see quite nicely that this f0.1 here, that this gives us here a peak exactly at f0.1, which works pretty well. We could now just play a bit with that and set, for example, the Q factor to 2. So we have a very bad Q factor. So for that we need to recalculate our pole, and for that we need to recalculate our IIR coefficients, because it goes in there, and then we recalculate our frequency response H and have a look what the difference is. So let's call this here figure 2 and also plot this here in comparison. So that's now Q factor 2. And so we see here that's a Q factor 2, that then the resonance is much wider, whereas a higher Q factor gives us a more narrow resonance here. Okay, so one might wonder if we need to do this all the time, all these mathematical steps here, and the octave of MATLAB comes to rescue. So in MATLAB and octave, there's a command called frequency Z, and this just takes our FIR and IIR coefficients and creates us a frequency response. So that's very convenient. So if we just write something like H and then frequency Z of B comma A. So I just write this here as a small h, that we see that there's a difference here, and so now obviously we need to recreate our lint space command with the new length. Oops, this was with a capital H. So, let me close this here and so I do the plot ups H here and pull this on the screen. Then we see the frequency Z command shows us exactly the same as before. There's also a more convenient, more powerful version of this. So if we're omitting this argument here at the beginning and we're typing in frequency Z, then we are getting a complete breakdown of our filter here with the passband area, stopband area, and the phase. Whereas we need to be careful here with the frequency axis, because now the frequency is normalized here to 1. So that's a MATLAB octave convention that Nyquist frequency is at 1, just as a warning. But the command is quite useful to get a quick idea how the filter looks like.